11. We're bringing you all the action and excitement brought to you locally by Marianas Irrigation and Landscape and Docomo Pacific.
KUAM News Headlines is presented by Calvo's Insurance, a legacy of trust, serving Micronesia since 1938. Matson, celebrating 25 years of commitment to Guam, Micronesia, and the CNMI. Cars Plus Hyundai, home of the Kona electric vehicle, an electric heart with an SUV soul. Test drive yours today at Cars Plus. McDonald's of Guam, I'm loving it, and King's Restaurant, serving your local breakfast, lunch, and dinner favorites for over 45 years.
Ahead on Primetime, lawmakers continue discussion on correcting a mistake in a local war claims bill. Plus, a bill that will create a USDA-certified slaughterhouse on Guam went up for a public hearing. And the Guam Department of Education is eyeing January for their face-to-face module to return to full-week instruction. These stories and more on Primetime.
Half a day and good evening. Republican senators are not brushing aside a costly mistake made by legislative staff that resulted in the governor signing a bill that opens up the local war claims program to thousands more potential claimants. After a series of delays during an already rescheduled session, legislative clerk Renee Meno was finally brought in to explain to senators, including Republican Joanne Bryan, how Speaker Terlahi's out-of-order amendment made it into the bill.
As far as the floor amendment, it was placed where it should be, and then when it transitioned, the comment that was left there was specific to a technical. So the focus was that language was there. As far as the proofreading of the language that was there was a somewhat of an oversight.
I'm a little concerned now. I'm being asked to be a proofreader. And unfortunately, probably for the rest of this term, I'm going to have to be for my own sense of comfort, which is totally unnecessary because it's not in the history of the legislature the normal process, even though I see public statements being made that every senator missed this. I mean, we have key people here. That is the main job that they're supposed to perform. So if that slips through, if this was a little technical mistake, it had some substantial impact to the whole intent of the bill that has caused a lot of upheaval.
Senators were supposed to be focused on fixing the war claims bill by removing the amendment that was mistakenly added. They recess until tomorrow without getting to that discussion. And a bill to establish a USDA-certified slaughterhouse on Guam to jumpstart local ranching and meatpacking industries drew plenty of discussion during a public hearing today. Nestor Lakanto reports.
The measure by Senator Clint Rigel directs GIDA to develop an RFP for a public-private partnership. It also transfers 2 acres of Chamorro Land Trust property for a site and appropriates up to $3 million in financial assistance. But the CLTC's Angie Camacho, testifying on behalf of Trust Chairman John Regis Jr., said they support it in theory but have a few concerns.
Do we want a slaughterhouse located over our aquifer? Is the processing or pre-processing facility, is this a processing or pre-processing facility or both? To expand the leakage potential in both process is high, and how would it be contained to not have negative impact to our northern aquifers? Is there sufficient infrastructure to support this type of facility?
Meanwhile, the Department of Agriculture's John Borja urged support of the bill, saying a certified local slaughterhouse is long overdue.
Age of farmers that are gradually disappearing, but it also gives a momentum for the potential for new livestock producers, new generation. And I'm seeing a lot of interest of the growing need for a livestock slaughterhouse.
Thomas Camacho says the intent of the bill is good, but its contents are flawed. He represents a separate group called Guahan Livestock Producers Cooperative, which is working on the same slaughterhouse issue.
I was not invited to this table, but I brought my chair, Madam Chair, because it's important for the community. It's important for our people. It's important for our island. It's important for sustainability. And all we are saying is let us continue working on our plans, because at the end of the day, we would provide this legislative body with a concrete plan that would be sustainable and modeled to fit this island.
Camacho adds that there have been three attempts by the Agriculture Department in the last 31 years to launch a certified slaughterhouse, with so far no results. For Guam's News Network, I'm Nestor Lakanta.
29-year-old Augusto Borja Camacho Jr. has been identified and arrested for his role in the escape of detainee Anthony Camacho from the Department of Corrections on Tuesday morning. The two are brothers. Camacho was arrested for hindering apprehension and resisting arrest. Anthony was located in Mongmong several hours after he escaped from the DOC quarantine facility in Mangilao. He was found and apprehended with Augusto in a car near the Benson store area. And 31-year-old Fia Tangaluya Aki pleaded not guilty to manslaughter and aggravated assault related to an altercation that occurred at a restaurant in Tamuning that claimed the life of 23-year-old Jaron Welbacker. Aki, along with 22-year-old John M. Muliaga and 36-year-old Joseph Decady, were arrested for the October death. Aki has been serving in the U.S. military for 12 years and moved to Guam from American Samoa in 2019. His next hearing will be in front of Judge Alberto Tolentino. And the Guam Department of Education announced that all grade-level students enrolled in the face-to-face module of learning could be returning to their campuses for a full 5-day of instruction by January. KOAM's Isaiah Ugin has this report.
Guam Department of Education Superintendent John Fernandez appeared on the link Wednesday morning, stating that the department is eyeing January for the resumption of the full 5 days of in-person instruction.
We had an opportunity to meet with our high school principals, also meet with our Guam Federation of Teachers to get a better understanding of how best to approach, you know, what we think will be, the end of this this Delta wave, and getting back to hopefully 5 days of instruction for all grade levels. So I think I can at least, you know, even though we don't have a date right now to tell you, what we're looking at is the at least the target of January being the date for all grade levels to be able to return for face-to-face instruction.
Fernandez says that the department will consider several factors like lower numbers of COVID positive cases in the community before making the decision to transition from scheduled cohorts back to 5 days of in-person instruction.
If that trend continues to go downward, we should hopefully in the next 2 or 3 weeks be back to a situation where we're out of high risk based on the CDC framework that we've been following. Canopies, tables, and chairs for schools that have requested that support in order to facilitate physical distancing, that's going to be helpful coming in over the next several weeks.
Fernandez adds that COVID vaccinations for children 5 to 11 years of age would be among the considerations to make the switch back to 5 days of face-to-face instruction. The department made the decision to have students in the face-to-face module of learning return to campuses in cohorts in September after the governor lifted the suspension of in-person instruction. Fernandez noted that the transition back to a full 5 days of instruction will be phased in from high school to elementary schools. He says that they plan to have discussions with the Guam Education Board, students, and stakeholders first before making firm decisions to return back to face-to-face instruction. Reporting for Guam's News Network, Guahusi Isaiah Ugin.
And soldiers from the U.S. Army's First Corps will be arriving on island, where they will be here for the next few days training and standing by live at the airport in Tizen. To tell us more on their visit is our Tyler Matanani. Ty?
Hafiday and good evening, everyone. Tyler Matanani reporting to you live from Gate 16, where the U.S. Army's First Corps will be arriving any moment now. Joining me tonight, they're going to be here for a training event. Joining me tonight is PAO of the National Guard, Captain Mark Scott. Mark, please tell us, what is the U.S. Army First Corps going to be doing here, and how long will they be here, and what can the community expect?
Sure. Hi, Tyler. Thanks for joining us out here at the airport. So we're waiting for the arrival of some of our friends from the United States Army's First Corps. They're going to be flying in here in a couple of their C-17s and offloading some vehicles called Strikers. Now, these Strikers are going to be loaded with some equipment that they want to test out here. They'll be parking them at our National Guard compound down at Fort Juan Munia and just doing some tests. But mostly, it's really to show that the I-Corps, the First Corps, you know, is a partner of us here on Guam. They're interested in the safety and the protection of the people, and they'll be here for about a week. So with regard to impact to the community, they're not going to be out in the town. They're not going to be impacting the community. But there is going to be a short convoy later on tonight Once those vehicles offload from the planes, they're going to convoy down with a police escort down to Fort Juan Munia. So they will have a police escort. We just remind everyone to please stay safe, and you don't have to expect any delays.
Thank you so much, Mark. Again, you guys heard it live here from Gate 16. The U.S. Army's First Corps will be arriving any moment now for training for a week here on island, and the public can expect no delays whatsoever with community affairs. Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm Tyler Matanani. Back to you in studio.
Thank you so much, Tyler. Once again, our Tyler Matanani live in Tizen. And switching gears just a little bit, once again, we invite you to voice your view across our social media pages with our daily question. Today we ask, will you get your children ages 5 to 11 vaccinated if the CDC accepts that recommendation to approve it? We'll share responses tomorrow on The Link. Stick around for more news here on Primetime. You're watching KUAM.
Yaman, reintroducing the Tumon Pans with plenty rice. Every day of the week, Tumon Jamaican Grill has a special for you. For $20, Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays features jerk chicken and ribs. Thursdays, the sweet and tangy Jamango barbecue ribs. Friday, check out what we caught for you in our fried local catch. And finally, our weekend family platter is only $50. That's $9 off. Yaman, Tumon Pans. Call to order 647-3000 or 4000. Yaman, Jamaican.
Don't need a work break, keep the smile on your face. The moments you can't replace, and I'll be around.
Wherever life takes you, we're always here for you. Calvo's Insurance. Count on us for life.
It's a special delivery to your inbox every week with your KUAM News Roundup, program advisories, and promotions. Sign up for the weekly KUAM Digital Digest today on KUAM.com.
Welcome back. Renters in need of assistance are encouraged to apply for the Emergency Rental Assistance, or ERA, program by this Friday, November 5. DOA will then momentarily pause on accepting online applications and office submissions for ERA to allow for review and processing. ERA will resume accepting applications on November 22nd. You can apply online at www.doa.guam.gov via email or in person at the ERA office located on the second floor, suite 219 in the IDC building. For more information, you can call 671-638-4518 or 9. The CNMI is shifting its testing strategy given their aggressive contact tracing. They're encouraging only those who may be exposed or experiencing symptoms of COVID-19 to be tested, stressing that testing only provides a snapshot in time that requires personal quarantine to truly reflect their status.
I think people misunderstand that testing, once they're tested, they're negative. Okay, I can go out and do anything. That's really not the right purpose for the testing. You know, so anyway, but it does help. It does help to find those that really do have exposure and they don't know about it.
So far, only one case was identified through the recent community-based testing, which can accommodate about 500 people a day or about 1% of the population during each testing event. The rest of the recent positive cases were identified through contact tracing efforts. CNMI Hospital CEO Munya also shared that vaccinations for kids is expected to roll out this weekend.
We are expecting shipment to arrive on November 6th, and once we receive them, we are actually rolling it out on the same day.
They're expecting over 2,700 doses of the Pfizer vaccine in the shipment, in the initial shipment. And in more regional news, the CNMI House probe into Governor Torres's expenditures continues to escalate. Among more legislative subpoenas issued this week, documents sent to KUAM confirm that former Senator Will Castro was issued a subpoena on October 29th. He's expected to appear before the JGO committee on November 19 at 10:30 in the morning to discuss first reimbursements for meals, hostings, and gifts claimed by or on behalf of Governor Torres and First Lady Diane Torres. And they also want to hear testimony on travel and meetings conducted or claimed by FBI on or behalf governor and the first lady, also involving reimbursement requests. And staying with regional news, the Sinumized Judicial Branch handed down its own vaccination and testing requirements Tuesday afternoon. All employees must be fully vaccinated no later than December 3rd, and those who decline to get vaccinated or show proof of vaccination must submit a weekly negative test result starting on December 6th before entering the workplace.
And the Supreme Court itself has issued up to 15 COVID orders for how we are to operate as a judiciary through the pandemic. And so the issue is not new for us. We have been tracking CDC guidelines and also promoting and advocating the vaccine project, as well as wellness in general.
Those with medical or other reasons seeking exemption from vaccination or testing can submit documentation to their human resources and administrative officer by December 3rd as well. The CNMI judiciary employs 96 total people on Sipantinian and Rota. Meanwhile, the executive branch had one of the first vaccine mandates implemented by Governor Torres for its employees. The legislative branch currently has no such mandates. And GCA Trades Academy recognized some of their participants today who completed their programs during the COVID-19 pandemic. The Academy, founded in September 2006, offers a large variety of training programs such as electrical, plumbing, carpentry, construction, craft laborer, and safety, to name a few. GCA Trades Academy couldn't hold award ceremony showcasing the accomplishments of their students due to the global pandemic. Education Director Bert Johnston explained that they plan to hold these celebrations for the next year.
Today we've chosen to start off a program where every month we're going to give out certificates to the people that have completed our program. In the past, we've collected a lot of certificates primarily because the pandemic didn't allow us to do that. And so in small groups, we want to recognize those individuals that have completed the program and get the certificates to them. And so beginning today and every first Wednesday of the month, we'll be giving out certificates to our students that have completed their programs.
Some 360 Island residents have successfully gone through their programs since the start of the pandemic. Johnson noted that GCA Trades Academy is now located in Tiza, next door to the Guam Department of Education. And for this week's Inside Business, our Tyler Matanani takes us over to Hagatnya to see how the pandemic has impacted a longtime locally owned business.
Addis Trust and Investment Inc. is a locally owned and family-owned business that has operated for over 40 years. Their primary focus is the development, management, and leasing of commercial leasing properties. President of the company, Sonny Atta.
We lease to doctors, lawyers, banks, barbershops, small businesses. So we have a variety of tenants that we manage.
Sonny says the impacts of COVID, coupled with the constant changing of government mandates, forced the company to adapt, start assessing operations, and seeing everything from a worst-case scenario.
What we would do in some cases is lower rents now, but extend the lease term later. So, you know, we have to work with each other. I mean, worst-case scenario would have been to, you know, terminate leases and have empty spaces. In this way, we were able to keep cash flow going and extend it out longer. When you have your bars and your eating establishments that are basically told to shut down, that was a hard time for them and a hard time for us, so we couldn't press them. You know, our look was, if the government shuts you down, then how could we consciously hit you for rent?
He says the key in keeping operations up was communicating with tenants on the different funding and programs available.
We've also had to sit down with almost every tenant and kind of iron out where we're going with them. But the important thing was to keep them in business. If they're in business, we're in business. So we've had to take some hits, we had to take some delays, but again, we've managed with almost every one of our tenants to keep them on board, and we've kept just about everyone operating, and if anything, we've picked up some new tenants.
Although they're bracing for harder times ahead, they're also positioning themselves for better days.
Now for fixing up properties, non-structural or non-safety improvements, we're attending to that now. We look forward to doing that. We need to keep our buildings clean. We need to keep our island looking good.
With Inside Business, I'm Tyler Matanani.
Sports is up next with Dave Delgado. Keep it here. You're watching KUAM.
Your community calendar is brought to you by Taco Bell. Whether it's your first meal or your fourth meal, we've got you covered. Taco Bell, live mas.
My name is Samantha Titano. So I'm actually the executive director of a nonprofit. So just people who are looking for a different pathway that's going to lead to a secure job, but isn't necessarily thought of as the traditional path. You know, there's a ton of opportunities on this island for the trades, lots of jobs available, and people are always hiring for them. And you can, you know, if you become a skilled and reliable worker, you can definitely move up in the construction industry here.
Taco Bell is so good and so cheap.
I know, right? I wonder why.
What if they know we're broke? What if they're trying to be the good guys?
Thanks, Taco Bell!
From now until December 31, enter to win the 1 million Pacific Points giveaway. Simply activate your account, refer friends, earn and redeem points at Foodies, Shell, and ITE. Learn more about the 1 million Pacific Points giveaway at PacificPoints.com. Pacific Points. Do more. Get more.
100% truck. 100% Jeep. Experience next-level off-roading on your new Jeep Gladiator, the most capable off-road midsize pickup truck crafted for adventure. Equipped with best-in-class towing capacity, legendary 4x4 Jeep capability, and backed by KUAM's only lifetime powertrain warranty. Drive home in a 2021 Jeep Gladiator today, starting as low as $315 per paycheck during Jeep Adventure Days. Visit CarsPlusGuam.com to get pre-approved online today. Terms and conditions apply. Cars Plus, driven by you.
KUAM Sports is brought to you by Docomo Pacific. Better together.
Dylan Kitigwa, who's back home in Hawaii after taking part in the 240-mile Moab race in Utah.
I'm just getting back on my feet, kind of getting a clear head. And that race was, you know, it was a 240-mile foot race with, you know, limited amount of sleep and limited amount of time for me to do it. They had a cutoff of about 113 hours. And so it was a 5-day race. I was able to get about 1.5 hours of sleep per day. And I did about 2 marathons a day to finish that race.
You're still looking to become the first Chamorro to climb Mount Everest. How are things going for you, and what steps are you taking in order to make that dream a reality for yourself?
As you might imagine, the Moab 240 was a very strenuous and arduous race for me physically, spiritually, and mentally. And so what I'm doing right now is cultivating a lifestyle of hard work and determination and consistency to really get my mental side ready for the climb of Mount Everest. And I'm seeing a lot of awesome strides with my physical fitness, as well as getting my story out there. I'm trying to show people, fellow Chamorros that I am serious about climbing Mount Everest. Here, look at me. I just finished running 240 miles in the desert, and you know, the desert had a lot of snow and a lot of heat, and I experienced both weather extremes there, and I experienced a lot of exhaustion and a lot of self-doubt. But by triumphing this race and finishing it, finishing a race that many people had dropped out of and many people didn't have the mental fortitude to finish, I felt that I was creating for myself the mindset that I'm going to need to be the first Chamorro to climb Mount Everest.
And since telling your story, what has the response been from family, friends, people who just may have heard your story that want to contribute? Because the last time we spoke, it is a very costly climb for you.
Yeah, the last time we spoke, we talked, it was about, I think I gave you a number ranging from $60,000 to $90,000. And you know, the response has been awesome. There's been a lot of moral support. There hasn't been a lot of financial support, but what has been really cool is that after our talk, the Learn Tomorrow Project approached me, and they're doing this project called A Million Miles. The whole idea of this project is in the year 2022, they're trying to do a cumulative 1 million miles in 1 year. And so that's the whole community of Guam trying to come together to do a million miles. And so I'm actually going to spearhead this fundraiser that they're doing in March by running the perimeter of Guam, and not the 48 mile race that goes on, but the actual full perimeter from the southernmost point to northernmost point, around 90 miles. And that is, again, to raise awareness and show people that maybe don't understand what 240 miles is, but people in Guam can understand, yes, I'm going to run the entire road that circles Guam. And it's been awesome. I've been working with Troy Agan, who is the executive director of the nonprofit, and they've been really helpful with me. And they're trying to help me get those sponsors, get all of the information out there that, you know, it helps them, but it also helps me. But I'm really trying to drive home the fact that I want to do this for myself, for my culture, my family, and for all Pacific Islanders.
And in programming news, make sure to keep it locked to the stations of KUAM for all of your NFL action. Monday, November 8th, KUAM TV 11, 4 in the morning, NFL on CBS, the Las Vegas Raiders at New York Giants. Switch the channel over to KUAM TV 8, 11:20 in the morning, NBC Sunday Night Football, Tennessee Titans at Los Angeles Rams.
KUAM Sports is brought to you by Docomo Pacific. Better together.
Building on the past, we at Docomo Pacific Business believe in helping businesses move forward and together, changing the way we get things done to make you and your company reach your highest potential. Trust in our commitment to bring you the best solutions for all your business goals. We are Docomo Pacific Business. Let's work better together.
At the Vocal Box, we understand that everyone is different, which is why our meal plans are designed to fit different lifestyles. Whether you need easy and convenient meals because you're on the front lines, breaking personal records, or just trying to live a healthier lifestyle, we have a meal plan for you. Our meals are made with the most fresh, all-natural ingredients that are always grain, gluten, and refined sugar-free. Spend less time cooking and more time living. Call us at 922-BOCA, visit our website, or stop by our cafe in Hagatnya to start your meal subscription today. The Boca Box, real nutrition made daily.
And before we close out the news tonight, our latest round of birthday shout-outs from the Cold Stone Creamery Birthday Club.
November 3rd, happy birthday wishes to Midas Brian Jude Borja. Happy first birthday to Midas of Inalahan from your whole team. They say we love you. We hope you have a golden, golden birthday, Midas. Kirti and Mindiola, happy birthday to you, and may God bless you on your special day, and may you have many more. Your whole entire family sends you all of their love. And Joe Villagomez, happy birthday to you, sir, from your entire Carisu clan. They say, we love you 3,000. Hey, Avengers Assemble, and happy birthday to each and every one of you.
That's going to do it for us here on Primetime. Thanks for watching, and have a good night.
In Full Zoom is presented by Calvo Enterprises, Inc. and IT&E.
Off a day, everyone. Nestor Lakanto here with another edition of In Full Zoom. And this week, we're going